Growing up, my grandma always told me that the land took care of us, and it still is taking care of us, and it never asks for anything back.
It is a way of life to always honor the environment. It's not something that you just can turn on and off. It's a living daily lifestyle.
And that acknowledgement is a way to acknowledge that we're coexisting in this land with the native people, and we should acknowledge that this is actually their traditional territory. But at the same time, we are all guests to this land.
The land plays a big factor in who we are. That's what makes us strong. That's what makes us strong people.
Yeah.
Hello, everyone. I would like to welcome you to this afternoon's program. This program is in partnership with Chinook Historical Society. We are so excited for the topic on Stanley James, Cowboy, and Newspaperman in Alberta, 1893 to 1897. Before I pass thing over to Jackie Klein, the president of the Chinook Historical Society, I just want to go over a few housekeeping information about today's program. So the program will be about an hour and a half in length, wrapping up around 2:30 today. If you have any questions, they will be answered at the end of the program. Please feel free to leave any questions that you have in the chat. You can find this at the bottom toolbar in Zoom. As well, if you need to change your view at all throughout the program, you can find that button just in the top right corner. Without further ado, I'd like to pass things over to Jackie. Thank you so much for letting us have this opportunity with the library for the program. Thank you.
Thank you. Welcome, everybody. It gives me great pleasure to welcome you here this afternoon to this program. On behalf of Chinook Country Historical Society. And I'd also like to thank Southern Alberta Pioneers, who was instrumental in referring us to Robert in terms of his research and therefore being able to present this topic today. I'd just like to remind you that our next program, before we take advantage of today's program, will be on December the 3rd in the evening at 6:30. And Leah Hennell, a photographer who has worked extensively in Southern Alberta, will be presenting her book Along the Western Front and talking to us about her photography of ranches, people, and places in Southern Alberta. But back to today's topic. It gives me great pleasure to introduce Robert Nurden, our speaker today, and technology is allowing us to beam him in from London, England. So there are some advantages to our current reality of only being able to do virtual programs. Robert is an author and a journalist who has written for such notable publications as The Guardian, Independent on Sunday, and The Daily Telegraph. Today's presentation represents 3 years of research and writing about the life of his extraordinary grandfather, Stanley James. Stanley was a complex and contradictory man, and we're about to learn more about him today. Over to you, Robert. Thank you.
Hello. Thank you so much for giving me the chance to tell you about my grandfather's adventures in Alberta in the 1890s. Although, as I speak, we're nearly 4,500 miles apart, I feel a strong connection following the trips I took over there in the summers of 2018 and 2019. I've lost count of the number of people who helped me in my research. My talk is tied to my biography of Stanley James, Between Heaven and Earth, A Journey with My Grandfather, which is out now on Amazon, and I'll give you details about that later. Usually, I talk about the whole of his fascinating life, but as there's so much Alberta material to draw on, today I'm focusing on the 4 years he spent in the foothills of Alberta. Before arriving in Canada, Stanley spent six turbulent years in London trying to find a suitable career. He rejected the wishes of his father, Daniel, a Congregational minister, that he should follow him into the Nonconformist Church. This rebel from the genteel life of late 19th century suburbia craved adventure. He had flunked his university course, chucked up his training program for the ministry, had three teaching jobs, which he really didn't like, and even given acting a whirl, all with unsatisfactory results. He didn't know which way to turn. So when in 1893, his younger brother Norman announced he was emigrating to Canada, it was the break my grandfather needed. Without any hesitation, he joined his brother. He was 23. But it's worth noting Stanley's bleak feelings on leaving England. He wrote, "No convict on the point of being transported to Van Diemen's Land could have felt more hopeless of the future than I. Faith was dead. Ambition too had succumbed. It is scarcely possible to exaggerate the sense of desolation with which I set sail for the New World." The brothers arrived in Halifax on the SS Parisian, pictured here, on the 2nd of April, 1893. They had very different characters. Stanley, the older, was earnest and high-minded, a thinker and searcher after truth. Norman was always laughing. He loved life and he liked to play practical jokes. Anyway, they bought an all-in package that took them as far as Winnipeg, from where they made their own way to Calgary. Population at that time, not much more than 5,000, my grandfather says. There they found some work in the foothills. My grandfather's first job was almost certainly at Mitford. The already well-heeled Tom Cochrane had brought his family from England with the idea of making a fortune from ranching, but nothing went to plan. His herd of cattle died of starvation his second winter there. When Stanley arrived, hopes of establishing Mitford as the center of a large ranching business were still high. Cochrane needed to get his cattle and workers across the Bow River, and Stanley's job was to help build the bridge. He recalls how on his first day he was given the tricky job of teamster. He writes, "I made innumerable mistakes. These contributed to the gaiety of the party. I was given all the jobs that involved the risk of falling into the torrent, though it was clear that, had I done so, swimming would have been of little use." When on my research visit to Alberta, I read this out to Roy Copythorne, whose grandfather would have known mine, he smiled knowingly. "The Englishmen who came over here were always the butt of jokes," he said. "They were seen as gullible. This they would have teased the hell out of him. If you were a foolish goose, there was always someone willing to pluck you." Stanley then landed a more secure job with W.W. Stewart, whose ranch was on the banks of Jumping Pound Creek. Stewart was an Englishman who came out west for his health, first traveling to Colorado, then arriving at Jumping Pound in 1886, where his brother Duncan had established a ranch. They bought a herd of cattle in Manitoba and drove it an incredible 800 miles to the ranch, and it was said to be the longest cattle drive in North American history. Stewart's ill health eventually forced him to give up the ranch, which was bought by John Bateman in 1905. Stewart hated drifters from the old country, but despite that, he took my grandfather on. Before coming out to Canada, I'd found some ranch images from 1893 on the Glenbow Museum website. In two of them, This is the first one. And there's the second. In two of them was a fresh-faced youth who really didn't look like a cowboy. But he did look a bit like my grandfather. I needed to check with the ranchers, so I brought photocopies with me. As soon as I could, I headed down to where I thought Stuart's ranch had been. It was there that I bumped into Jim Bateman, who surprised me by knowing exactly who I was. My wonderful fixer, Bev Copythorne, had sent an email round to all the ranchers in the district saying that this Englishman was coming out to trace his grandfather. There we are. Jim invited me in for coffee, and there on the wall was another photo, this one pictured here, from the same 1893 set, but one I hadn't seen before. There again was that fresh-faced youth who didn't look like the other gritty cowhands. Could it be Stanley? And I'm referring to the guy in the front row, the only one not wearing a hat. I'd brought over photos of him taken before he left England and some after he got back. I showed them to Jim without saying anything. Unprompted, he pointed to the ranch photos and exclaimed, "That's your grandfather, no question." I conducted the same experiment on other Jumping Pound ranchers, and they all concurred. It was Stanley. I met no less than 5 men whose grandfathers have worked alongside mine in the 1890s. Copythorne's, Bateman's, and Sybil's, of course. For a researcher, it doesn't get much better than that. The photographs by an S.A. Smythe were taken on the XC Ranch at branding time. An amazing find, 127 years after they were taken. It was just chance that Stanley happened to be there and that ranch was chosen as the one that for the photographer. Before I headed off to XC Ranch to meet Tom and Patty Copythorne, Jim took me to see the confluence of Jumping Pound Creek and Little Jumping Pound Creek. The ice-cold water tumbled over the pebbles, making a restful, clattering sound, just as it had in Stanley's day. Jim saw me ruminate and walked away, kindly leaving me alone for a few minutes. The tears that welled up in my eyes as I thought of the grandfather I never knew took me by surprise. Sue, my partner back in England, is a dressage judge. And when I got back, I showed her the photo of Stanley sitting on a horse, and she instantly remarked that he didn't know how to handle his horse. He's holding the reins tight, and they're not fixed to the bridle, a sure sign that something's not quite right. No surprise then that when Stuart took him off cowboy duties and asked him to teach his young daughter Jane, a fact recorded in the book Chaps and Chinooks. And here is the photo. Jane Larrington, as she, that's her married name, is sitting on a basket on the far right in front of Stuart's house. As an adult, Jane Larrington wrote in Chaps and Chinooks, "I had been taught my ABCs from a young Englishman who was of no use on the ranch. He had left home because he wanted to be an actor, and his parents were determined that he should enter the ministry. Eventually, he gave in and returned to England." It has to be my grandfather. Eventually, Stanley did feel more at ease in the saddle and joined in the branding roundups. But he says he deliberately appeared stupid so that his real self could hide behind a mask. He admits he was lazy, but he liked the camaraderie. "Near me," he wrote, "lived a poor former Parisian clown and a Russian count. I had come to a country where everyone was an exile. When I got to Jim Bateman's house and land, I was surprised to see that Stuart's house is still there, dilapidated, but a great connection with the history of 120 or more years before. Stanley wrote, "I settled down in neither one locality nor occupation. I passed from east to west and from north to south, traveling light and heeding not the direction so long as I was moving. I was like those people who decide their course by reference to a pack of cards or by opening a book and taking the first word their eyes fall on as the word of fate." This work was not without its dangers, according to Stanley. Twice he was tossed by bulls, and on the first occasion was gored, sustaining two cracked ribs. He was caught in blizzards. Once he got lost on the prairie and experienced, quote, "something of the panic that has driven men mad." Another time, riding on the edge of an abyss, he avoided being swept out of the saddle by the bough of a tree by flinging himself along the horse's neck. He writes of how he made butter by putting cream in an old cocoa tin, which he then tied onto the horn of the saddle, and in the course of the day's riding, it would be jolted into quite passable butter. In winter, he cut spruce and larch for fuel and building material. He went into partnership with an older man who had a team of horses and a sleigh and a contract for wood in Calgary. The system they adopted was to chop and load one day and drive the consignment into town the next, returning the following day. He wrote, "The work in the bush was the most enjoyable of all the physical labors, oh, save that of riding, of course. The crash of a snow-laden tree leaving a gap through the Rockies, which could be seen, was music to my ears. The swing of the axe and the resinous smell of conifers are treasured memories." On occasions, he was called to help fight a forest fire. He recalls the loneliness of living in a hut by himself too. He wrote, "From my shanty, I looked up at the frosty stars and listened to the song of a bird as it rose, died away, and then grew louder than before. And I looked out into the night, which seemed to hold its breath. There arose the low howl of a coyote, which is perhaps the most dismal sound in all nature's repertoire of sounds. My blood was chilled as I realized that for miles around, there was no other human being. When I was there, I heard it too, and I have to agree with him." My grandfather, who was later to describe himself as half English, half Welsh, and half North American, had no desire, unlike his workmates, to make money quickly. But he loved the overall experience. He wrote, "In both a spiritual and physical sense, ranching had been the rack on which I had been stretched to man's size. I shall never forget the camaraderie of the range and the shack sing-song." A summer of sheep herding provided Stanley with one of his happiest periods in the foothills. He clearly relished the isolation involved in looking after 2,000 sheep. He remarks that the sight of another rider on the horizon was, quote, "like the appearance of a ship to sailors tossed on some derelict raft." He lived in a shepherd's wagon, so small that a passerby remarked that there was no room for a mosquito and the resident to be inside at the same time. The most important and most risky part of being a shepherd was keeping the coyotes at bay. he missed the company of women. He comments ruefully that the scarcity of females was, to some extent, remedied by the education department, which ended up acting as a marriage bureau. When a vacancy occurred at the schoolhouse, an advertisement would appear for a new teacher, woman preferred. The schoolmistress would no sooner settle down to her duties than one of the cowboys would start paying her attention, and later the wedding would take place. Soon after, an advertisement for her replacement would appear in the press. The poem he wrote shows the appreciation he had for the charms of Albertan women. He wrote some poems, and I'm going to read you two, if I may. And the first one, these were both published in the Calgary Herald. The first one is called "Her Bright Eyes So Sparkling." It goes like this. "Believe me, fair reader, if all the dear charms of the maidens I've met in my day were all placed together and close to my arms, the Albertans would surely hold sway. For a heart that is beating and pulsing for thee, for a heart that is loving and true, for the maid of Alberta whose charms I can see in her bright eyes so sparkling and blue. If all the dear maidens of lands I've seen were to place their dear hearts at my feet, I would spurn them and turn to my Alberta queen with fond kisses so loving and sweet, that no doubt would arise in her dear little mind that my fond love was thoroughly true, I as true as the beauty I always shall find in her bright eyes so sparkling and blue." The longing for beautiful women continues with "The Cowboy's Plea," a variation on the old ballad "The Cowboy's Lament," I believe. And it went like this. "A cry from the cowboy comes to us, a sorrowful, pitiful wail. It is wafted on gentle breezes, on the powerful gale. Wherever we hear it, 'tis ever and always the same. Oh, for some charming woman to wear our euphonious name." The females in sunny Alberta number not as forests leaves. The market is short on the former and long on men and the beeves. Now, while you are importing cattle, give heed to our modest request and bring in a train load of women whose pedigrees rank with the best." Clearly, feminism was not a widely used word in those days. Right. Stanley and Norman were not remittance men. For one thing, their father didn't have enough money to send them survival envelopes, but they undoubtedly worked alongside some, pictured here, and here, lovely old photos, I think, also from the Glenbow. In my research, a book that was very useful to me as background for this period was a book by Mark Zilke, "Scoundrels, Dreamers, and Second Sons." And in there, he recounts an episode which I think must have impacted on Stanley. And I'm going to read from my book the episode that Mark refers to. He refers to one R.C. Dickie Bright, who certainly was a reckless and original remittance man. And the chances are that Stanley knew him and spent time with him, as their dates and the area they lived in fit exactly. The Englishman, whose grandfather was Richard Bright, the first person to describe the clinical manifestations of the kidney disorder that came to be known as Bright's disease, had a small homestead on the Bow River, and he loved to party and drink in Calgary and guaranteed his monthly flow of money by telling his father that he was building up a flourishing ranch. In fact, he had just one horse and no livestock. The game seemed to be up when his father, becoming suspicious, paid him a visit from England. Cunningly, Bright quickly borrowed enough cattle from neighboring ranches to assemble a large herd. The ranch where Stanley was working was likely to have been one of these. When his father commented on the dilapidated ranch buildings, his son merely countered by saying that he was sinking all his funds into establishing the herd. His father left satisfied, and the money kept on coming. Bright's sisters arranged to come for an extended stay the following summer. So Bright could not repeat the ruse, as the particularly harsh winter had killed off thousands of cattle whose skeletons were scattered over the foothills. As he showed his sisters round, he cursed his luck that his herd had been destroyed in this way. They were fooled. The sisters returned home to their father with their brother's tale of woe, and the money continued to flow. I am sure Stanley and Bright would have shared a drink or three at the Alberta Hotel in Calgary. Writing was in Stanley's blood, so even on the ranch, he found time to pen some words. He started sending reports to the Calgary Herald, and in that way became the unofficial jumping pound correspondent. To this day, I'm not sure how many people knew he was doing this, because his articles were either anonymous or he used a pseudonym. It meant that he could cheekily criticize ranchers and not have to worry about the consequences. I spent hours online and at the Glenbow scouring the Herald pages, and because I could recognize his style, I found lots of his pieces. The pressing issue of the day was irrigation. Many settlers between the rivers Bow and Elbow wanted to try arable farming, but were restrained by the brief 90-day growing season that the climate allowed. The poor quality of the land and the fact that it was too dry in the summer and too wet in the winter added to the challenge. A plentiful supply of water, it was argued, could increase the chances of success. Locals in Jumping Pound, Springbank and Spruce Vale lobbied local and national politicians to grant them the necessary licenses to dig trenches, which would divert water away from the Elbow and Jumping Pound Creek to irrigate over 21,000 acres. Stanley reports on the numerous meetings. An outspoken band of landowners in Jumping Pound didn't want the project, let alone the heavier tax burden. They were ranchers, not arable farmers, and not interested in changing. Eventually, everyone reached a satisfactory compromise. On my visit, Roy Copythorne showed me the experimental dam that had been built on his land in the 1890s to contain the waters of Jumping Pound Creek. There were still rusting, broken flumes lying at the bottom of the stream, legacy of the failed project. And this is my photo I took a couple of years ago, and it's Jumping Pound Creek. And around about this area, though, you can see the rusting pipes and flumes from that project. Roy also pointed out the one irrigation channel that had been built across acres of land between the creek and the Elbow. On one occasion, Stanley crossed the line in a report with a personal jibe that was stronger than usual. He wrote, "There was a meeting concerning irrigation, presided over by a chairman of portly appearance. I wrote in my report that the chair was filled to overflowing. The man in question was said to be looking for me, but luckily he never found me. Over the four-year period in which he wrote, there were frequent references to flooding. Bridges collapsed and fields were submerged, small ranchers suffering dreadfully as a result. Once, a visiting government inspector made his boat available to the locals. Stanley's articles called on landowners to repair their bridges without delay so day-to-day commerce could recommence. A particularly invasive flood in 1897 saw all the bridges at Jumping Pound and Mitford, including the one that Stanley had built in 1893, collapse into the river. Tree trunks swept down from the Rockies and blocked the flow, despite Stuart's valiant efforts to divert them away by assuming the part of a lumberjack. When vast numbers of cattle died from blackleg after eating a poisonous plant, Stanley's uncle recommends they be inoculated with garlic to counteract the debilitating effects. How efficacious this would have been is unclear. Hunting coyotes and wolves were a regular weekend sport. Meets were frequently organized, and everyone who could ride was expected to take part, the men proudly recording the amount of booty they collected. But later, as a joke, Stanley turns protector of wildlife by writing a humorous piece about an imagined emergency meeting of endangered coyotes. In this invented fantasy, the animals pass the motion that Jumping Pound is becoming intolerable, the number of dogs and the sporting instincts of the community being in complete antagonism to our interests as coyotes. And further, this meeting desires to put on record its a special condemnation of the Copythorn brothers, who encourage and abet said dogs in their depredations, and also of Mrs. R. Copythorn and Mrs. Stewart, who lead the men on in their iniquitous course of coyote murder. The motion was passed unanimously. I did say at the beginning of this talk that Norman was the joker and Stanley was the high-minded serious one, but I probably need to change that image a bit because he also had a great sense of humor. News briefs give a sense of the ebb and flow of local life. Winter was the time for bachelor dances, the entrance money raised going to good causes. No doubt it was a rare opportunity for cowboys to meet local women and vice versa. There was the usual record of births, marriages, and deaths. A Mr. W.J. Wade died when his team of horses backed over the riverbank and crushed him. And the newly married and legendary hostess, Mrs. Fraser, died suddenly at 21, just as she and her husband were starting to make a going concern of the Collins ranch they'd just bought. In the winter of 1895, Stanley wrote two farces for the locals to perform in the schoolhouse. And then he promptly reviewed his own creation and performance for the paper. "Does your mother know you're out?" his report runs. This is his farce, the first farce. Was received with enthusiastic applause. This little piece, the author of which is Mr. Stanley James, went merrily from start to finish. Though Mr. James acted in the spirit of burlesque, it was no less satisfactory. Modesty was a trait that seldom troubled my grandfather. Stanley usually sent his reports to J.J. Young, editor of the Calgary Herald, by mail. In early 1897, when he delivered his report in person, Young offered him a position on the paper. Stanley leapt at the opportunity of what would have seemed like creative work. Besides, he'd had enough of ranch life and needed a new challenge. On his last day, before moving to Calgary to take up the post, he climbed a nearby hill and looked down on the area that had been home. Bill Brateman drove me up there in his 4x4 truck, and it's now known as Bateman's Hill. Together we stood where Stanley had stood. Far to the west was the cloudy outline of the Rockies. To the east, the flat lands of the prairies. Bill, alert to the power of personal histories, stood in silence and let the mysterious passage of years sink quietly into my soul. After all, his grandfather had worked side by side with mine. In those days, the Calgary Herald was a daily paper, requiring two columns of local news, with a weekly edition for outlying districts. It meant Stanley, apparently being the sole gatherer of news, had to do the rounds of the drinking saloons, not only in Calgary, but in the rural areas. He wrote, "I soon acquired the habit of drinking with all sorts and conditions of men, which might have had serious consequences. Even as it was, I drank far more than was good for me." One of those drinking dens was undoubtedly the Alberta Hotel pictured here from that time, which boasted the longest bar between Winnipeg and Vancouver at 125 feet, apparently, quite long enough for Stanley to engage in several different conversations over the course of an evening and to earwig others when perhaps he shouldn't have done. I too sat in the hotel's cavernous interior and listened and watched as smart-suited business folk discussed fluctuations in the value of oil shares and potential markets in real estate. Stanley also attended inquests and court sessions, interviewed visiting celebrities, and covered theatrical and other shows. He recalls how people frequently paid their subscription, offering the paper a sack of potatoes or a few pounds of butter instead. He tells us, however, that he produced an 8-page supplement aimed at the growing number of gold prospectors heading for the Klondike fields in Alaska. Its purpose was to persuade them to make the journey through Calgary rather than through British Columbia. I found this impressive document in the archives of the Glenbow. My grandfather's special edition contains informative articles on the benefits of following the Peace River, avoiding the dangerous rapids while recommending the best camping spots. It was also stuffed with ads which Calgary retailers hoped would separate prospectors from their money. Here's one for beer: Buffalo brand aerated waters. Calgary beer is famous. We've made it so. All the goods are equal to the best. A trial will convince you all. And another one for clothing, wrapping up warm as they headed north. Allen, A. Allen and Son Outfitters, opposite the Royal Hotel, Calgary. And they're selling Mackinaw, I pronounced that right, and heavy wool clothing, lined overalls, duck and leather jackets, mitts, gloves, hats, caps, Arctic underwear, etc. Working at the Calgary Herald enabled my grandfather to widen his circle of acquaintances and to enjoy a fuller social life. One of those he was closest to was a Scotsman he calls in his two autobiographies Bob MacDonald. I tried to establish if the drunken, stony broke, and utterly unscrupulous journalist he describes was none other than the legendary Bob Edwards, who in 1902 was to publish and edit the Eye Opener newspaper. If he had known Bob Edwards, it was in his interest to give him a different name so his identity was kept secret. Unfortunately, I haven't been able to determine the truth, but there is no doubt that Stanley relished the unruly company of anarchic, intelligent, and dishonest men. Joining these two in digs was an impecunious lawyer who made a point of taking a circuitous route into town to avoid his creditors. Then there was the deaf architect, upon meeting you in the street, held up his hand to his ear and said, "I don't mind if I do. A little scotch, please." One day, in late summer 1897, J.J. Young fired my grandfather. The reason seems to be connected to an editorial Stanley had written, which criticized the misleading pamphlets being issued to lure miners from Great Britain to Alberta on false pretenses. Admirable journalism, it seems, but it was too much for the boss to stomach, and Stanley was sent packing. Penniless, he headed south to Lethbridge, where he'd heard that a cattle train bound for England needed a cattleman. But when he got there, the train had already left. So he retraced his steps, all 130 miles of them, back to High River, where he'd heard there was a haymaking job going. He walked alongside the railway track virtually nonstop for more than 24 hours, too afraid to rest because of the rattlesnakes. I followed his route in my hire car out on the lonely plains. This is my picture from summer 2018, I think. In the long shadows of the early sun, I felt close to his adventurous spirit, thinking of the time he'd paced along the same bit of gravel as I was on. It was very moving. I was the only person around. The sun had just come up. And another time like a jumping pound where I'd felt his adventurous spirit. In High River, he landed the job, but first needed to catch up on his sleep, all 18 hours of it. With the haymaking over, and this time having enough money for the full fare, Stanley returned to Lethbridge, which in these days was a burgeoning coal mining town. Norman had opened a shop, the Emporium, whose sign announced "Cosmopolitan Store, Knickknacks and Novelties." Apparently, one day, a woman came in and asked, looking from one to the other of them, "Say, which of you fellas is Knickknacks and which is Novelties?" This ad was in the Lethbridge paper in December 1897, and I found it in the Gault Museum in Lethbridge. Not far away, the Crow's Nest Railway Pass was being built, and a large number of relatively well-paid navvies had their camp at the end of the line, but nowhere to spend their hard-earned cash. Stanley borrowed a wagon, a team of horses, and a bell tent. He loaded up supplies of tobacco, mouth organs, braces, handkerchief, and notepaper, among other things, and pitched his tent right in the center of the camp. Very quickly, trade became brisk and profits grew. He found the temptation to join the railway workers impossible to resist and temporarily worked as a navvy. Before long, he was on the move again, this time heading for Toronto. It was goodbye, Alberta. He was never to see this part of Canada again. But in his books and lectures, really for the rest of his life, he is always to refer fondly to his time out west. but he had one more adventure to undergo before returning to England. He enlisted in the American army and fought the Spanish in Cuba and Puerto Rico in the War of 1898. He notes that during the battle, he aimed his rifle into the air to ensure he didn't kill any of the enemy. It was, I believe, the first sign of his pacifism that became an ideological position in England about 20 years later. But that's another story for another time. So he returns to England and he meets Jess, my granny. So I'm now going to give you a very brief resume of the rest of my grandfather's life. On his return to England, he did eventually become a Congregational minister and married Jess. It was in the North London suburb of Walthamstow that he rocked the boat, embracing communism, pacifism, and women's emancipation. The physical adventures of the prairies were replaced by adventures of mind and spirit. He authored 9 books by his death in 1951, and it's all recorded in my book. A family photo from 1916, all 7 children. My mother is the one on the left with the bucket and spade. That's Jess with David on her lap and the other children. There's one more thing to say. Stanley, as a father of 7, had an affair and other liaisons with women in his congregation. I unearthed the original diaries and letters of these 3 radical women, which are in the Women's Library of the London School of Economics. I found his and their love letters, which I quote extensively in the book. They make for quite extraordinary reading. In 1916, with the Battle of the Somme raging, Stanley was forced to resign from his church. There followed a period of political activism until, probably exhausted and perhaps feeling guilty, he converted to Catholicism, declaring that he had finally found the truth. From his garden shed in Hampshire and using a decrepit manual typewriter, he turned himself into a freelance journalist, becoming one of the most celebrated Catholic authors in the English-speaking world, writing as much for the North American journals as for British ones. He died in 1951, 7 months after I was born. One brief note about Norman. He stayed in Canada and married Etty, a Lethbridge girl, in 1899 and bought some land in Youngstown. In the 1930s, he became a representative for the Social Credit Party in Arcadia and then in Edmonton, becoming one of the movement's leading lights. Norman died in 1963. So Stanley was very much someone caught between heaven and earth, as the later part of his life bears out. What I've described is obviously his time in his 20s, when he was still very much having adventures of a physical nature, but he was a great thinker. And as I said, he became a Catholic convert. And that's my book, the cover of my book. And if you were interested in buying it, that's how you can do it. It's available on Amazon. Thank you very much for listening. And now, if there are any questions, I will try to answer them.
Well, thank you so much, Robert. That was so very interesting. And I especially enjoyed seeing all those photos, especially those old ones. Wonderful. And what an outstanding person your grandfather was.
Thank you.
We do have a few questions. So the first question would be from Jackie. What surprised you the most in your research?
Well, to be honest, I haven't dwelt on that very much. So what happened between 1906 and 1916 in Walthamstow was totally unexpected in my research. And I just touch on it at the end there about the letters and diaries of three women who were in his church and the liaisons he had with them. They contain amazing literature. And one of the letters from one of the women involved has ended up in the Virago Book of Love Letters, published in 1993, coming immediately after a letter by Maud Gonne to the poet W.B. Yeats, and before one by Violet Trefusis to Vita Sackville-West. So Minna, the nurse from Walthamstow, who also helped my granny in the house with the children, her letter to her friend Ruth, in which she confesses her affair with my grandfather, is in that book. Amazing sandwich between these two VIP letters, if you like. So that I haven't dwelt on because there was so much Alberta material to talk to you Canadians about. But that was surprising. I mean, I found the research of my two trips over there absolutely fascinating. And because my grandfather was a little bit vague and he changed names of place names, one of the reasons I had to come back a second year was the first year I was pursuing an area called Two Rivers where he said his ranch was. And I thought I had found it along the road to Banff, out of Cochrane, where the reservoir is. Apparently, it's called Two Rivers by the indigenous people, but it became clear later that other things didn't quite fit, so. He called the confluence of the Jumping Pound Creek and the Jumping Pound the Two Rivers, and it took me a while to realize that what he was meaning, and that brought me back again so I could explore that area. So to sum it all up, the research was as interesting as the writing, I think.
Yes, well, thank you. I just wanted, we have a question from Mark. He is interested in knowing more about your grandfather's job on the railway, Navvy or?
Navvy, yeah.
Can you tell us a little bit more about that, what that is exactly?
Well, he doesn't go into it in great detail, but the Crow's Nest Pass Railway, I think, started from Lethbridge and went west. I mean, you probably know more than I do. He just mentions it in passing, and he sort of gravitated towards any sort of adventurous job going. So I don't know how long he was a navvy for. I don't think it could have been very long before he got on the train, and in fact, he was a hobo for 3 weeks, traveling from Lethbridge to Toronto. But the Crow's Nest Pass Railway was being constructed then. I'm sure some of the other listeners would know more about that than I do.
Okay, thank you. Jackie asked, are you also as adventurous as your grandfather was?
Well, Not anymore, but I was a great traveler. I was actually employed as a travel writer for the Independent, and I wrote pieces for the Telegraph. So I've been to, I think, 60 countries in Africa, Asia, and Europe, and North America. And I've worked abroad. I've worked in India. Perhaps I've probably been to more countries than his, but I think my adventures were not the same as his, but I roughed it using rucksacks around Africa and Asia. Yes, a good deal. It's in, and the other members of my family are great travelers, and they've all, so there's people in Canada who are part of the James family, and in South Africa and in Australia, as well as England. So there is, it is in the family blood, yes.
Well, that's wonderful. Sean Hunter, who is our historian in residence at the library, said that she thanked you and she for the presentation, and she said that she's interested in two poems that you read. Are you able to tell us when they were published in the Herald?
His articles, they would have been between 1893 and 1897. Yeah. Okay. Probably 1894. He didn't get going till 1894 to 1897. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you. And we have a comment from another participant here saying that Navi was the herd of horses and their caregivers. So I guess that was about Mark's question. I also didn't know that. So thank you, Anita. And Sean is asking about the dates of the poems.
They appeared, well, it would be, again, they were in the Herald, so between 1894 and 1897. I have got somewhere in my files the actual dates. I don't know them off the top of my head. If he wanted to, I could let you know. And
Sure. We can definitely pass that on if you send that to us later.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yes, excellent. Thank you. We still have time. Please send us your questions if you have or comments. If you can type them in the chat, or if you'd like to ask directly, we can unmute you and you can just ask your question. There is one question from Tim. How much time did Stanley and Norman travel together?
Well, they came over together, so that was March, April 1893, and then they crossed right across Canada, and they got to Calgary traveling together, and then they parted their ways. So Norman worked in Pridis and Millerville as a cowboy, doing similar occupations to Stanley, and he wrote an autobiography, which was published in Canada and is available, and it's called the Autobiography of a Nobody by Norman James. And I think the publishers were Dent, and it was translated into French as well. That was published in 1947. And that is a real knockabout fun, not always reliable memoir. It's Clive James, the Australian writer, who called his early autobiography Unreliable Memoirs. I think Norman could have given his book the same title, but it is very funny. And he describes how he became a representative of the Social Credit Party in Alberta, almost by mistake. I don't quite know whether it's how true this is, but there was a convention meeting with 12 candidates for being elected to the party were gathering, and they had 4 minutes to make a speech. And Norman was number 12. And when the first 11 had given their speech, he was nowhere to be seen. But he was eventually discovered hiding behind a grand piano in the corner. And he was dragged out and made his speech. And it was so brilliant, or anyway, it appealed to the audience, that he got voted in. And that's how he started his life as a politician. That's his version of it. But to go back to your question, so they were, 20, 25 miles apart, jumping pound to Pridis. And so they used to ride over and see each other at the weekends. And then, as I described, when Stanley lost his job at the Herald, he went down to Lethbridge and worked in the shop with Norman for a while. Stanley came back to England in 1899 and for a while, really lost touch with Norman. Norman joined the Canadian forces in the First World War and came over to Europe to fight. Stanley, as I've already said, was a pacifist, so ideologically they would have clashed. And it's not recorded by either of them. In fact, Stanley's not mentioned in Norman's book at all. And Norman is hardly mentioned in Stanley's book. It may just be that it was their book and they didn't want to spend time talking about a relation, I don't know. But they must have, because of that pacifism issue, they must have had very different views about war. But one of the wonderful discoveries I made in the Glenbow when I was over there, and thanks to the archivist there, who I was going in to write to, so those cowboy pictures had captions. Some of the names were known, like John Bateman in the back row. But there were some cowboys, then the names were not known. So I went in to meet the archivist and gave him Stanley's name. So that is now in the caption. But when I was there, he said, oh, by the way, there's something on that trolley over there that you may find interesting. And it was all of Norman's archive material, which he donated to the Glenbow in the late 50s, early 60s. He died in 63. All his speeches for Parliament, he did a column for the Social Credit Party newspaper, and also some private correspondence. And I found, I think it was 11 letters from my grandfather to Norman, written in one in 1936 and the rest in the late 40s. And they'd obviously been out of touch for years and years, because Stanley has to tell Norman that he had converted to Catholicism in 1923, and this was 1936. So they'd obviously been out of touch for at least 13 years. But at the end of his life, Stanley would never really had much money. And the seven children and Norman used to donate money to him and Jess, who were living in Hertfordshire by this time. And Norman used to send a joint of ham from Edmonton for Christmas to help things along. And in those letters, they seem to have grown closer together again. I don't know how many times Norman came over to Europe. There was one occasion in the early years of the 20th century when he wasn't making anything of the land he had bought in Youngstown, and got fed up with trying to establish the farm there, came over to England and to Devon to try and find a farming position there, perhaps as a tenant farmer. Nothing came of that. And he and Etty were in contact all the time, across by telegram or letters across the Atlantic. And he was getting fed up with, and he wanted to come back to Canada. She was missing him. And they both decided to get on the boat at the same time, and they crossed in mid-Atlantic. So she ended up in England, he ended up in Canada, and he had to wait for her to come back. Norman has his adventures too. But I don't know how, Stanley probably met him in when he came out, when Norman came over to England, but I don't know how much.
Well, thank you. I would just like to apologize that I do have some difficulties with my computer and with my screen. I can still hear, and hopefully you can hear me too. You just actually answered the question that someone asked, how about their relationship after Stanley went back to England. Mm. Thank you for that. And I will need to ask my colleague Catherine to help me continue while I see if I can fix my computer quickly.
Perfect. So I'm just reading through the questions, trying to figure out where we left off. Mm-hmm. We have lots of comments in here talking about how the presentation was so fantastic and how they really enjoyed it and how it was very interesting. So we have a question from Gregory. Did Norman and Stanley continue to have a good relationship after Stanley's return to England?
Robert talked about that. Yes. Okay. Yes. So it was almost completely answered. You almost like you knew that someone will ask that.
Wait, is that Gregory Ball from Vancouver?
Yes. It is a Gregory. Yeah.
Hello, Gregory. We've never met, but we've been in touch by email.
I'm back. I don't know what happened.
Okay.
Sorry about this. We are trying to do our best with what we can in the times like these. Sean said that she liked your grandfather's observation that in a place that in the place here in Alberta, everyone it felt like everyone was in exile. But I would just like to add to that, but he went back, right? So,
yes. So
that's interesting. Can you maybe talk about that a little bit? Why did he say that? I mean, I can assume why he said that, but as I said, he did go back.
Mm. I think his roots in Wales and England were very strong. His father was a very strong, although they fell out, his father was a very strong influence on him. I suppose that the life of the mind and the spirit and everything was more to attract him in London and England than the prairies, important as the prairies were for his sense of freedom and throwing off all the suburbia of South London that he didn't take to. And also, he was also in Croydon as well and didn't enjoy that. So he needed that period of 6 or 7 years in the wilds, if you like. But I think he was, because he was a writer and needed to be among writers, and that's what he found in London, and political movements, it was almost inevitable that he would be drawn back to urban life, although he rejected it. He needed to reject it for a while. It doesn't surprise me that he came back to Europe.
And that what I meant was, like, probably some other people living there at that time, maybe they didn't feel like wanting back where they came from or not being able to, which he was. And I think that's good. That's nice. that having that choice.
Yeah, sure. Yeah.
So we have a question from another attendant saying, what do you think led to his pacifist views?
Ah, great question. I probably need to talk about my great-grandfather, his father, who was a very well-respected Congregational minister, with liberal left-wing tendencies. So that was an influence on Stanley, although they fell out because he didn't want to become a Congregational minister. But he was very idealistic. So those years, 1906 to 1916 in Walthamstow, he experimented with every cultural and religious progressive movement going. There was something called the New Theology, which was socialism and mysticism combined. It was very, very big in London for the early years of the 20th century. Women's emancipation. And then pacifism in the First World War. So in August 1914, Stanley went with the family for their annual holiday to the Essex coast, agonizing about whether he should declare himself to be a pacifist in the pulpit. He could be privately, but once he stood up in the pulpit to declare it, that opened a can of worms, if you like. Well, he did come back, and he was not just mild pacifist views, but passionate pacifist views. And that alienated huge numbers in his congregation. So the women in the congregation, their husbands or their sons were fighting on the front in France. And here was this minister who was exonerated from military duties, extolling the virtues of pacifism. They wouldn't like it, they didn't like it, and the deacons eventually forced him to resign. There may have been other reasons, but he joined, after he was sacked from the church, he joined two pacifist organizations, and this is what I talk about in the other talks I give to English audiences. He joined the No Conscription Fellowship and worked alongside Bertrand Russell, the philosopher, in the same office as an administrator. And then he moved to the Fellowship of Reconciliation, which was a Quaker organization. And then edited a pacifist journal called The Crusader. So he had these three things going on from about 1916, 17, right up to 1920. And when he was editor of the Crusader, he had a picture of none other than Lenin on his wall. So obviously he embraced communism as well. But he does describe in his autobiography how in the battle in Puerto Rico, he refused to kill any of the enemy and fired above their heads. It was a very heartfelt position. He was passionate pacifist, and there's world another need...
I just think the world needs more people like him, that's for sure. I hope most people would agree with me. That's wonderful.
Yeah.
Sorry, I interrupted you. Go ahead.
Well, I was just going to say there was a massive opposition in 1916-17 to pacifism. And there was a famous occasion, I think it's 26th of July, 1917. There was a church in Hackney, which is also in the East End of London, called the Brotherhood Church, which was really not a church at all. It was a communist debating chamber and a pacifist debating chamber. It was the only safe place where pacifists could meet without any questions being asked, book their meetings. And word got out that on this day, the pacifists were meeting there, and Bertrand Russell was among them. And I'm not sure if Stanley was there, but he might well have been. And the whole church was surrounded by 8,000 angry mob and they broke in, broke up the chairs, and attacked the pacifists. They deliberately broke open, destroyed pieces of furniture so that their nails were exposed on the furniture, and threw these pieces of furniture at the pacifists. Bertrand Russell was about to be attacked, apparently, when someone whispered in his ear that he was an aristocrat, whispered in the ear of a policeman. The police were standing by doing nothing to defend these pacifists. But anyway, someone, just as Bertrand Russell was about to be set upon, someone whispered in a policeman's ear that Bertrand Russell was an aristocrat. And so the police police defended him. Yeah, pacifism was very, very controversial position. But as you say, it was as brave to be a pacifist as to perhaps to fight. I don't know.
I think so. Mm. There's a question about your grandmother, Stanley's wife. Was she a feminist?
I don't think she would describe herself as that. She was a very maternal figure, and she didn't, as far as I know, she didn't involve herself in Stanley's searching and looking for meaning. She was keeping the family together, seven of them, and on with very little money, but doing an amazing job. So their preoccupations were very different. I knew my granny. She died in 63, so I do remember her quite well.
Nice. We have a question that you already talked about at the beginning of Q&A. What was the most surprising find in your research? You mentioned the affair that you found out about. Is there maybe anything else that you would like to add?
The route to finding that out was an extraordinary adventure of research for me. It's rather a long little tale. It might take 5 minutes. Have I got time to tell it?
Sure, yes.
Idly one day in the middle of writing and researching, I Googled Stanley James Rockies, and what came up was an extract from a book by an American historian called Seth Coven, and the book is called The Match Girl and the Heiress. I've got it here. There it is. It's a very long social history about the early years of the 20th century in London in the East End. And in it, on page 321, and this is the extract that came up, I read this. The signatory who most egregiously violated the spirit of their Christian revolutionary vow was Stanley James, a man of roving ways and unsettled religious convictions. He had been a cowboy in the Canadian Rockies and a rail riding hobo in the American West. When he returned to Britain, he assumed his father's Methodist pulpit in Wales, married and started a family. He eventually drifted to London, apparently without his wife and children, where he worked for the Fellowship of Reconciliation, sometimes edited the Crusader, and delivered stirring pacifist socialist sermons to his nonconformist Walthamstow congregation. He also grotesquely abused his ministerial authority to seduce idealistic, vulnerable female congregants. And when I read that, I was shocked, obviously. And he goes on to quote this letter from Minna Simmons, the nurse in Walthamstow, to her friend Ruth. And Minna writes, "Well, dear, we went into the front room alone and he kissed me, opened my dress and kissed my breast too. And he said how he felt I was his. He was just going away when he came back and pleaded with me, dear, to give him everything a woman can give a man. I told him I was sure we should regret it, but no, dear, anything that would make me his. Well, dear, I did. The tears I have shed have quite washed away any wrong I did." I wrote to Seth that very same day and I said, I'm Stanley's grandson. I was shocked to read what's in your book. And he wrote back the same day and said, "Oh, I'm not surprised." But his source, to carry on with the story, his source is another book called Dear Girl, which is the collected letters and diaries of those three women written by a feminist writer called Teal Thompson, who spent weeks and months in the basement of Ruth Slate's flat, a house in Blackheath, processing all these documents, amazing writing, and producing this, first of all, a play for the stage and then for BBC Radio, and then turning that material into the edited letters and diaries. And so I got hold of that very quickly and read it. And my grandfather appears in that book, I think it was 40 mentions of him. Then the last part of that research, which is really the most, one of the exciting elements of doing the book, was for me to go to the Women's Library in the London School of Economics and for about 3 weeks, go through all the boxes of Ruth's possessions and letters and diaries and read it all. So looking at it from a different angle from Teal, who was looking at the relationship between the three women, but I was looking at it obviously from my grandfather's point of view. And that, when I found out those letters, it completely turned the book upside down. Mm-hmm. And I realized I was writing a very different kind of book to the one I was set out to do. Mm. But I hadn't dwelt on that in this talk because I was just keen to talk about Alberta material, but it is all in there, and I think it makes fascinating reading.
Interesting, yeah. We have a question from Caitlin. She's asking, when do we look forward to you returning to Alberta?
I'd love to come. Yeah, I'd love to come. Well, when all the COVID's all over, we can take another trip.
Exactly, yes. Another message from Gregory saying thank you. It is so great to hear you talk. He says he's excited to read your book soon and will be sharing your book with his mom, Beth, who is now 89 and she is Norman's granddaughter.
That's right, yeah, fantastic. We'll be in touch, Gregory. Lovely to have you here.
Well, thank you again. This was really very interesting. And we still have a little bit time if anyone has some last minute question. Meanwhile, I would just like to thank you again and thank Chinook Country Historical Society for organizing this with you. And thank you to Jackie Kleiner, the president of Chinook Country Historical Society, for the introduction. Yes, there is one question coming in right now. It says, you have described your grandfather's affairs in romantic terms, yet today we would term it sexual abuse. Can you comment on that?
Yeah, that's a very good point. Exploitation of vulnerable women. I would go along with that. And in fact, in my book, I devote a page or two. A quotation from Teal Thompson, who wrote Dear Girl, about her view on his behavior. And so many of the things that she says, most of what she says, perhaps all of what she says, I would agree with. Yes. That it was many ways exploitation and maybe abuse too. Yeah.
Thank you. We also have a question from Elizabeth about the copies of your book, asking whether the library order. I would think yes. I can guarantee. I would need to check. I would also just like to tell everyone that you are always welcome to suggest to the library to buy some books if we miss it, although our collections department is really good on ordering everything that is relevant.
I've been in touch with Indigo to try and thinking perhaps that there would be a number of Canadians who might be interested in it. So that's an ongoing process that I'm not very expert about at the moment, but perhaps we could liaise over that, and you could educate me in how Indigo might go about that. I think because I published through Amazon, they would only agree to an online book, I think.
I can't really talk on their behalf, right? But yeah, we definitely can. Unless the library already ordered the copy of your books, we definitely can suggest that. And I probably will, yes.
Good.
Well, thank you again. I also would just like to remind everyone that the next program in partnership with Chinook Country Historical Society is on December 3rd. It is along the Western Front with Leah Hennell. It starts at 6:30, so please register for that one unless you already have done that. If we don't have more questions, I would just like to thank everyone for spending the Sunday afternoon with us and for the wonderful and interesting presentation, Robert. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Erica. I would just say, if anybody there's a number of people are interested in what happened to Stanley 1899 onwards for the rest of his life, which I've just touched on a little bit more in the questions, that constitutes most of the talks that I do give in England. I'd be very happy to do another one for Canadians covering that part of his life as well. So I'll just sort of drop that in.
Thank you. That's wonderful to know. Maybe we can organize something in the future with you again. Yes. Thank
you very much. It's great to be in touch for 4,500 miles away.
Exactly. Yes. Thank you. And so have a good night to you then. Because it's over 9 o'clock. In England.
Half past nine here, yeah.
Yes. Okay, well, thanks everyone, and have a good rest of the afternoon.
Thanks, Sarika. Thank you for hosting so brilliantly.
Thank you. Okay.
Bye.
Bye. Bye-bye.